Hello, I'm Gypsy Metalis, and welcome to Haitian Voices. The advent of the internet has revolutionized media, and Haitian media itself has evolved tremendously. So in this episode of Haitian Voices, we explore the diverse avenues that young Haitian media professionals are using this platform or these platforms to spread the news and relevant stories throughout South Florida. So today we welcome David Frederick, host of the podcast Impact the Outcome, Christalie Parisot, TV anchor for What's Up Haitian, and James Pierre, a TV producer and journalist. Welcome to all three of you. Thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you. So let's
begin with you, James, because I think that you've got this really exciting perspective around the history of Haitian media itself. So why don't you tell our viewers very briefly what it's been for us in terms of the key avenues to communicate?
Well, it's been thank you so much for having me once again. It's been a process back from Haiti since I started journalism in Haiti when we start with the Radio Communautaire, community radio stations in urban communities back after the second invasion of the United States Army back in that time. So we used to have radios operating only at night from 4 p.m. or sometimes 6 to 10. You know, you have small antennas to listen to broadcasting for 100 or 200 people. And then coming, that has evolved with Conatel now giving licenses to several stations, because these stations, they were not operating on the legal licenses from the government.
They were not operating legally.
Yeah. So now you have, bigger stations operating to broadcast for, the whole country. And then refer to that, you have now Haitian journalists from Haiti now inside of different markets in the U.S. market or French market, Hispanic market, as well as evolving. So that's the historical part of that moving on.
So with that history set for us, why don't you talk a little bit about yourself in terms of what you do now and how you think you've evolved in terms of a media professional?
Well, that's the name of the business. You're always evolving, right? So you cannot sit in one place and think that otherwise you become obsolete. So I started on radio back in Haiti as a radio personality, journalist, news anchor. Now in the United States, I serve as TV producer and anchor for MDC TV. I also
TV is Miami-Dade
College TV station, TV. Mm-hmm. And I also serve as political contributor for Mira TV, which is a Hispanic TV station. Work affiliate with CNN in Spanish. Also serve as guest on different panels for NBC6 or CBS4.
Excellent. And you've been at this now since you arrived here from Haiti.
Yes, right? so it will be 8 to 9 years now.
9 years now. Mm-hmm. Excellent. So Christalie Parisot, you are also a child who grew up in a household of media personalities. So talk a little bit about you, your background, and where you fit in this media mosaic today.
Well, as you just mentioned, I was really born into the media field. I'm the daughter and granddaughter of two Haitian media women. And ever since I was a little
pioneers, I want to say.
Thank you. And ever since I was a little child, I've been hanging around TV stations, radio stations. So it's something that I really do know. And I, for myself, I host a TV show on NBC Cozy called What's Up Haitian. We've been doing it for about 6 years now. And we broadcast local Haitian community news. We inform the people about what's going on in the Haitian communities. And I also manage our family marketing business. Mm-hmm. So I also work with all the Haitian media in South Florida. Okay. So I'm in contact with all of them, not just what I do. Mm-hmm. I work, I place advertisement, I do media buy, I communicate a lot with the Haitian media in South Florida. And I'm currently getting my master's degree in TV management as well.
Oh, excellent.
So these are the things that I do now.
Excellent, very exciting. So David Frederick, you're a podcaster. So tell us about yourself first, and then we'll get into what a podcast is.
Sure. I do the podcast, but also I'm a Sandler Fellow, which is an honor for me to be in that environment to learn about the Haitian community, the past and the present, and how we can put those things together to move in a more optimistic view with the Haitian community, as well as I am gladly a father. My son is about 22 months.
Oh, how nice!
So, which is a cool thing.
Podcasting too.
the funny thing is the funny thing. Whenever I'm editing it, is usually because we go around and plug the mic or unplug the mic, which is a good thing. And when I'm doing the research, reading about the history, because part of the podcast is talking about Haitian history, is it will be playing with the books and everything. So that's part of it. Also, I am doing my bachelor in FIU with international relations. So that's basically what I do. But
and so Impact the Outcome is a podcast. Yeah. And so what do you hope to achieve through that?
And when I think about podcasts in the first place, it's something intimate, you know, something that is like a one-on-one conversation you have with your audience. And I mostly see that call more out of obligation and passion. When I see every May 18th, like I was, I usually say it's when you know everyone is Haitian. After May
18th, May 18th is Haitian flag day.
You see in the car, you see at home, you see it everywhere. You see on Facebook, in Instagram. But after that, it's flat out. There's nothing else. I said, but there's more into our history than just the flag. The flag is important. It is a pivotal moment in our history, but there's a lot of important things.
So you're using Impact the Outcome to sort of communicate and convey the elements of Haitian history,
but also I talk about tourism. And the goal of the podcast is to reconnect the Haitian millennial like myself to Haiti, and I hope that they will know more about history, but also that they will be inspired to travel back and go to Haiti as well.
Excellent, excellent. So, James Pierre, we recognize that right here in South Florida, there are more than 120 at last count Haitian radio broadcasts, right? There are several, there are three or four TV stations, right? ITTV, Island TV. Well, we should count Haitian News or
Teriana Kauna as well.
Teriana Kauna, thank you very much. So that's about four. All right, so four TV stations, 120 radio broadcasts. We know that as a people, we come from this culture of radio and TV, right? And I think you started to explain why, you know, for a long time, disconnect, geographic distances, that's all we had. And so today in South Florida, right, there are 120 programs. So how do we assess the value of these 120? And what direction do you think they ought to be going in?
Well, it's now developing in the different platform, and interesting, you know, David was talking about the podcast. It's different to the Haitian community. Now, radio used to be a place for therapy, for information, to move on.
Okay.
And TV,
for therapy, huh?
Yeah, right? Because it's how you communicate, you know, if you listen to Haitian radio stations, is the place where you you can have an idea of what's going on inside of the community. We sell products, we do all of that. We talk about politics from Haiti. But now TV is bringing something different. Images from Haiti. You know, you have the music videos, you have all of that going on. But for the Haitian community, now you have Haitian Americans as well now wanting to know, do I need to stick with these programs, or do I need to go to Haitian American market?
Or the new platforms.
Right. So now you have TV shifting to not only showcasing what's happening in Haiti, but also creating programs related to the Haitian American community to say, hey, we have also airtime for you. You know, and Christalie Parisot's program is in English to show you, hey, you can watch news from Haiti or here in English. So they'll be able to understand better what's going on. The podcast of David is in English. So my show's English or Creole, French, or Spanish. It's for different platforms. So I think that's where we're going right now.
So then in terms of your own audience at MDCTV, who is your audience? And what is it they're hoping to receive from you?
Well, my audience varies because I have shows in English, in French, and also in Spanish.
Okay.
So the contents will obviously vary if it depends to the Haitian community. We talk more about what's happening in the Haitian community, spotlight on the important personalities in the Haitian community, showcase as models to others. So that will be specifically for the Haitian community. Hispanic shows more about history of Cuba, what's happening in the Hispanic community here. French is more for Europe and also countries in South Africa,
okay.
You know, African continent, where we have different countries where they speak French. We highlight personalities or, you know, great events that's happening there.
And so your audience is heavily a student population, or is it students and more? Students and their families,
student population, but also broadcast to the whole community.
Got
so
it.
Starting from students, because we are all students, right? We are all learning. This is, life is a university, so we all learning to grow from there.
Mm-hmm. Christalie, so what's up Haitian?
Mm-hmm.
Obviously targets the Haitian American community. And so what is the inspiration behind that? And where do you see this show going?
Well, I failed to mention that my show not only airs on NBC Cozy, but also on Tropic, which is a television station in the Caribbean Islands,
okay.
as well as in Miami now, as well, also on digital cable. So this show started off as an idea of integrating the Haitian American community within South Florida into the more Haitian events, the Haitian stuff happening, everything mm-hmm. Haitian. Because what we noticed is that Haitian Americans that are more Americanized don't really know what's going on in the Haitian community.
Okay.
For example, you have, as you said, about 120 programs on radio. They're all listened to by Haitians who are more Haitian than
right.
Americanized.
Very specific segments.
Mm-hmm. But the Americanized, the younger generation Haitian Americans, they don't know this stuff going on in the Haitian community because they're not really listening to these programs.
They're not connected to those programs.
Uh-huh. So there's a lack of integration in that sense.
Mm-hmm.
So What's Up Haitian, as James mentioned, is in English. We do incorporate some Creole in it because we want to keep our Haitian identity, but we make it so that everybody can understand it. We started off at first just for Haitians, and then we got a lot of feedback from people who are of Haitian descent, from people who are from other Caribbean islands, and they want to understand. They want to know.
They want to know. They want to be a
know
part
what's
of
going
the,
on. What
yes,
is that?
Of course.
We never see that, you know? So we decided to make it more English, and that way we opened up our doors mm-hmm. to the world. We mm-hmm. we opened up the doors to let other people know this is mm-hmm. what Haitians are doing. Mm-hmm. This is what is going on in the Haitian community mm-hmm. in South Florida. So in that sense, that's how we've evolved. And I believe that we should keep on using that same concept in all the media to continue to get other people involved. Because if we don't get the younger Haitian Americans involved, where is our community going?
Absolutely. And we're going to consider that in a few minutes. But
okay.
I heard you both reference, you and you, Christalie and James, you referenced TV cable, digital stations. And so mm-hmm. can you just quickly tell us where the Haitian media market falls along these two options? Cable versus traditional
I think you have the
networks.
Waveform, you know, where you don't need a cable provider to watch stations, so it's waves, you have an antenna, you can watch it.
Okay.
They still attach to that because it's less, you know, money
less. Mm-hmm.
compared mm-hmm. to that. But cable's still there as well.
Okay.
And cable is, you know, it's bigger, so you have more options to watch that. And several of these TV stations, Haitian TV stations, I believe, are on non-cable format. So.
And how huge would you all estimate the Haitian media market to be? You know, how many viewers could you assume safely there are? Well, now each of you could throw out your number, because I'm sure each of you has a different number.
Well, it's got census. If you look at South Florida, Haitian community is the second largest minority community in South Florida.
Give me a number.
And we are talking about millions. No, we are talking about millions of viewers, because when you watch a TV station, for example, at home, probably you watch with your kids or with your husband. So you are talking about this is a million
viewers,
market,
you would say. How many would you say, David?
I would
give
go
me a number.
More conservative, about 600,000.
600,000? Christalie, how many would you say?
I believe if you count Haitians who are recognized as Haitians, mm-hmm. you would probably be in the 100,000s. Mm-hmm. But if we're counting all the Haitian descents, mm-hmm. everybody who speaks a little Creole.
So that means those born here of Haitian parents.
Yeah, I would estimate 1 to 2 million.
Okay. Yeah. Wow. Interesting. Mm-hmm. Interesting. And so we see that media is of course shifting, and we see the shift in the Haitian mm-hmm. community as well. There are a lot of people engaged on Facebook, through Facebook Live. People are podcasting, and David, you're going to come in and explain to us, you know, how you create a podcast and how you maybe diffuse it, mm-hmm. right? So these new platforms are really creeping upon us. So is our community ready for this, right? So talk about the podcast first.
And for the podcast, I truly believe they are ready in a sense that you're part of the generation that they want it now, ready at their disposal.
As it happens.
Whenever
time.
They want it, yeah. So for the podcast itself, it's everyone has a phone, you know. You can see it on your iPhone, on your Samsung, any kind of smartphone that you have, you can have it, and it's available right in there, just like you upload your playlist. So that's why I think it's the future of it is important. And you can see even now the generic or the normal media like CNN, Fox News, and all these people are going to also some of their shows are doing podcasting as well, because they see where it's shifting. Mm-hmm. But the importance of podcasts, it's something that's made to be less professional, very relaxed, very laid back.
It's the average Joe being a journalist.
Yes, yes.
Community journalist,
yes.
If you will.
So it's something like you can just pull out your phone, you know, and do the recording, and being able to upload it on a website and diffuse it, like you said, to
countless
places. You know, we're talking about Google right. Play Music is on every Android phone, talking about iTunes, which is on every iPhone. Mm-hmm. Those two major platforms themselves like share the majority of people who have iPhone. You know, it's either you have iPhone or you have Android. So all these people anywhere in the world, you don't need to be here in Miami, but anywhere in the world. I've had, to my surprise, I've had people from Russia, you know, I've had people from Brazil, Chile, France, all these people just being able to just open the phone and see it. And while I'm here in Miami, just do the interview in my room, bring the guests in my room and do the interview, record it.
So it's an opportunity that's less costly.
Less costly, definitely.
It makes everyone potentially a journalist.
Yes.
It gets news out there in real time, and it's really democratizing.
Yeah,
news,
but the good things about the podcast is it targets a specific group. Uh-huh. That's where the intimacy comes. When you go into podcasts, you see so many podcasts because they target a specific, they don't go general. Like, uh-huh. For example, mine target Haitian American between 15 to 35 or 40.
Okay.
Like that's the kind of group that I want. And Haitian American that was born and raised, or people that was born and raised outside of Haiti and we don't know much. So that's specific, and where you in your topics, it can be, in a sense, they know you're talking to them. So you're not talking about all of those people, but the person who will listen to the podcast, they want to know that you are talking to them specifically.
You've targeted them very specifically.
Yeah. So that's
wonderful. So I guess you do that same degree of targeting for your own mm-hmm. for your own What's Up Haitian shows, mm-hmm. right? So what's in the future? What do you see? Where do you see What's Up Haitian evolving? How do you see what you do on television evolving, taking into account, you know, the podcast and mm-hmm. the various other ways that people access news today?
Yeah, I have to mention that nowadays, when you do television, you can't simply just do television. You have to integrate other platforms.
Such as?
Social media, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter. You don't see any big networks right now just broadcasting TV and not doing anything else. If that's the case, there's going to be, how do I say that? Like, the ratings are going to go down.
Of course.
You know, people, as it's been mentioned earlier, there's the millennials have.
Yes, there are the millennials.
The millennials want their news, their information right now, right there on their mobiles. I don't believe that TV is ever going to go away. I don't believe that it's dying, because some people are saying TV's dying right now. It's all about just social media. I don't believe so, because there's still this question of credibility. There's credible news. There's the media that you trust to get your true information, because you can be misled. You can be misled on social media very often.
Easily.
So TV is not going to go away, but TV definitely needs to
evolve to incorporate these new opportunities,
all the other platforms,
because that means new audiences too.
New audiences, and TV needs to make everything be one, not just be TV.
Absolutely.
So with that said, What's Up Haitian is aiming to not just stay on TV, but, you know, communicate with our audience through social media. We're
videos and
YouTube, all these things. So we're definitely going in that direction.
Excellent. What about MDTV?
Well, I think the same fear started long time ago, from newspaper, when you had introduction of radio, when you had introduction of radio.
It's a ritual for me. I've got to read my paper.
It's not going away. It may be going away
for some
on
people.
Paper, but it's finding new ways of, you know, of publishing news.
That's right. So, I'm sorry.
The introduction of radio, you know, in the American community was, oh, there's a fear, we have to change that. TV started in late 1940s, 1960s. Oh my God, TV's going to take over radio. Radio's still there, right? TV's still there. It's going to be the same thing, but we have to evolve with social media. Now, in my job, I have to post at least 4 to 5 times a day. It's mandatory, part of my contract, that I have to post. I have to interact with people on different platforms. I have to do live feeds, because it's part of your job, so the audience feel that I can touch you. You can give me a response away. So Haitian radios or TV stations, if they do not adapt to that new technological tools, unfortunately, you're going to be left behind, because that's how the world is moving that right now. And you have to adapt to it. That's just, there's not an option. You know, you have to. That's how it is right now.
So with that said, how do we help the Haitian American community? Well, in particular, those who are not too familiar with these platforms, or not too savvy in terms of their smartphones and the power that's in their hands. How do we encourage them to move in that direction?
Well, it started with education, your willingness, right? First, you need to know, okay, I don't know. I need professionals to teach me how to work this out. Second of all, I think we need to integrate more young Haitian Americans into this business, because they know already, you know, this is the generation of the new,
exactly.
So that's the first thing. Second, we need to educate them on that. You know, they need to understand, you cannot have a business right now. You can have a TV station without a proper Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. You need to constantly keep on posting, interact with audience, because that's how you're going to drag them to watch your show. It's starting with that.
But what I would say is, they need to know the show doesn't start and end within that 1 hour, 2 hour show. It's a daily thing. So you have to constantly, like you mentioned, posting, you have to have that continuity, engagement with them. So in a sense, to connect with them online and hopefully you'll bring them to your show or to that thing.
And this reality doesn't just rest with media. I see a lot of businesses moving in the same direction,
right?
In terms of their marketing tactics to different audiences using these platforms, right? So you're right when you say this is the way of the future. And so making sure that people, we all recognize this new reality, this new normal, if you will, understand that we need to all learn how to use these tools and these gadgets, right? Understand the platforms, how to access them, how to interact with them, and hopefully that positions us to be maybe better consumers and more critical consumers of news and information, wouldn't you say?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And I have to mention my show, which started 6 years ago. 6 years ago, it was very different. Only 6 years ago, there was less going on between, okay.
No, no, right. I'm sorry, go ahead.
6 years ago, there was less going on between the Haitian communities in different platforms. Mm-hmm. Now, a lot more Haitian Americans are getting involved. They're getting involved in the Haitian community. They're recognizing their roots. They are communicating with the Haitian people down here.
But I also see them getting involved with non-Haitian entities as well.
Which is
quite a few people, for instance.
Yeah.
Yes, go ahead.
Which is the beauty of social media. Mm-hmm. I'll give you a perfect example. Before I go on air to talk about a specific topic, right, I can easily say, I'm going to do a live about immigration. Mm-hmm. I will have hundreds of thousands of views, people all around the world asking me questions about what's happening right now in the United States before I even go on air. So they will also educate me on, hey, I think you should talk about that. You should mention that angle. So you have a world of assistant producer working for you.
Of course, unfortunately, we are out of time. It always gets good when we're out of time. So thank you so much for being here today. Thank you.
Thank you.
And I'm Gypsy Metellus. Thank you so much for watching.